choice. Let your moderation be known to all men. The Lord is near. Have no anxiety, but in every prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your petitions be made known to God. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. And the Holy Gospel is taken from the first epistle of St. John. In the name of according to St. John, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. At that time, the Jews sent to John from Jerusalem priests and Levites to ask him, "Who art thou?" And he acknowledged and did not deny, and he acknowledged, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Art thou Elias?" And he said, "I am not." "Art thou the prophet?" And he answered, "No." They therefore said to him, "Who art thou, that we may give answer to those who sent us? What hast thou to say of thyself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as said Isaiah the prophet." And they who had been sent were from among the Pharisees. And they asked him and said to him, "Why then dost thou baptize, if thou art not the Christ, nor Elias, nor the prophet?" John said to them in answer, "I baptize with water. But in the midst of you there has stood one whom you do not know. He it is who has come after me, who has been set above me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to loose." These things took place in Bethany, beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Thus for this Sunday's Holy Gospel. My beloved people, today I have a few things that I wish to lay stress on because of the coming feast. First of all, this morning, first things first, we receive calls, telephone calls, from all over the country. We receive cards and letters and notes from all over the country, even from other parts of the world. And in all of these telephone calls and notes and letters and so on, almost without fail, there is something that is in common with all of them. That is need. Urgent need. Sickness, terrible sickness, death, misfortune, death without priest, all kinds of problems with family, children, relatives, parents, etc. Everyone has an urgent and severe need. Therefore, as we prepare ourselves for the feast of Christmas, for the coming of our Lord, let us take a minute or two of our time this morning, those of us, and I might say you. It might sound strange to say, but it's the truth. You who have been given blessing, you who have been given a kind of a vocation, you are not here by accident, dearest people. Please kneel and pray for those who do not have what you've got.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners
now and at the hour of our death. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. May Almighty God bless us all. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And may this blessing remain with us all forever and ever. Amen.
In today's bulletin, there is an instruction which I certainly point out to you. In these next few days, we will all be quite busy in getting things ready for the birthday of a king, getting the things ready for the birthday of our blessed Lord. It is certainly not out of order for you to get ready. It is certainly not out of order for you with little children to maintain the excitement of the moment and to give to your little children the blessing of this occasion. Do not let anybody, I don't care where it comes from, I'm not speaking as the final word, but I'm as close to the final word as I can get. And that is, do not let anybody, wherever that anybody comes from, tell you that it is wrong and sinful to prepare for this occasion. It is not wrong, it is not sinful, and it is entirely appropriate and proper. And the next few days will be very exciting. My beloved people, fill your children's heads with the beauty of this occasion, with the beautiful excitement of this occasion, with the loveliness and the freshness and the crispness and the magnificence and the power of it. If you take this away from your children, you will create a void. And you know better than I that your children will put something into that void. Don't do that to your children. They deserve better than what so many children of today have. These children also, whoever they are, deserve better. But the only thing that they seem to be given is the street. Make your house so lovely, your houses, your homes, so lovely that your children, by their own volition, will not even care to go elsewhere to seek that which this season is supposed to give and does give. Do that for your children. Make your home that certainly, if Nazareth was at the moment, and if they themselves had been at home at that moment, they weren't at home because they were going elsewhere to perform the work of God. But if they had been at home and the occasion was similar to them as it is for us, you can be sure that Saint Joseph would have built beautiful little things that the Blessed Mother would have filled that house with the beauty that was appropriate for that moment. Go thou all and do likewise. Tonight, today is the 17th of December, we start the, as we pointed out in our earlier bulletins, we start the O Antiphons. The occasion of Christmas is so important, it's so urgent, and so explosively beautiful, and so heavenly tremendous, that the church in her wisdom could not wait, and it started crying out. Day after day now, as we approach the final day, and we call out to the magnificence of God and ask God in His magnificence to come down to us and to be with us and to help us and lead us and to fill our hearts with beauty. Those letters that I speak of and those telephone calls that I speak of or spoke of, they are missing, in many cases, that kind of beauty. And they are so hungry, so very, very hungry. It is a sadness in this very happy occasion. All of us, myself included, know the pangs of this. So in these O Antiphons, go there, read them. The father of the family has to be the one to read it. And if he's not there, the mother, not one of the children, the father or the mother, nobody else. These are solemn proclamations, very, very solemn. And if you can imagine what it must have been like in proper times when they were making the announcement of the coming of the Savior. And akin to that, I hope you still have last week's bulletins. Last week's bulletin spoke to us of all that our divine Savior did for us, all that Almighty God has done for us. And whereas we say, what have we asked, what have we done in return, let us perhaps not dwell so heavily on that at this moment, but rather let us dwell on the importance of the coming of our blessed Lord and Savior. What did He leave out for us? He did not ask us, and neither do we, He did not ask us to go step by step and do that which He did. He did not ask that. We don't either. He did not ask us to change a thing. Neither do we. We do not ask that we change a thing. The only thing that He asked, the only thing that we ask, is to change the reason behind what we do. That's all. Nothing more. How much does that require of us? Simply to change the reason why we do this or that. The sadness, Christmas brings out sadness that is not evident at other times of the year. Because no matter how much we fight it, we cannot and we will not obliterate the presence, the divine presence of the divine child at this time. And only those who cannot and who do not walk in the warmth and feel the warmth of that presence, they are the ones that are hurting. They are the ones that are suffering. They don't admit it, and they go to the most bizarre things to cover up their sufferings, to cover up their longings. And they put all of their emphasis in the material things that this occasion brings about. The material things are great excitement. We all gather together, and all of the things, the boxes, the pretty boxes, oh, how much trouble we went through to pack them up, to wrap them up, to tie them up, to get special ribbons and golden ribbons and pearled ribbons and all kinds of magnificent ribbons and things. And we spent hours, perhaps, wrapping up a single box because it has to be so beautiful. Then somehow, after we all get together, somebody gives a signal. And in less than 5 minutes, the house looks like a hurricane hit it. With paper strewn every place, ribbons torn, ripped boxes, everything. And within 5 minutes' time, in so many places, Christmas is over. And if you go around, drive around town, say about 1 or 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, how many Christmas trees do you find out in the gutter? Because, as some say, to keep your Christmas tree beyond that time is bad luck. We have really gone the whole limit, haven't we? My beloved people, when the beauty begins is when we close the book, don't we? So much for that. Next Sunday is the Sunday that everybody dreads. It is Bread Sunday. You must bake your own bread. It doesn't matter if it doesn't rise. It doesn't matter what it turns out to be. You have done it. It has to be you. It has to be in the family. It has to be the mother who make the bread. It is the most effeminate, the most delicate, the most ladylike, the most Mary-like thing that any woman should want to do and be glad to do. It is the battle against the false effemininity, or whatever you want to call it, that is running rampant today. It is the delicacy of Mary who made the bread. And unless she had made the bread, there would be no bread. And the bread then is brought to the church. You can bring as many loaves as you wish. And the priest blesses this bread, and it is brought home. Then the father of the house, the father of the family, takes over and blesses that bread. And he goes and blesses each member of his own family, his wife, his children, or visitors, if there are visitors there, that he takes the bread himself that has been given to him by the mother, and he breaks a chunk. He breaks the bread into one piece at a time, and he reaches out to whoever in the family. And then the member of that family reaches back and accepts the bread. You want to know, it takes more courage and stamina and manhood and womanhood and childhood and brotherhood to do that. One little simple thing. Than it would be to go out and stomp the pavement for whatever people stomp pavements today. That's where courage comes in. And your faith shows the difference. Bring as many loaves of bread as you care to. They will all be blessed, and you can keep them and eat the bread at other times at your discretion. Sunday Vespers today will be at the usual time, but next week they will not. Next Sunday will be a very, very, very pressing day, and our Vespers will be at 5:15 rather than 5 o'clock and will not have benediction next Sunday. But today, everything is normal. Now, concerning Holy Communion, if you receive Holy Communion at the 10 o'clock Mass next Sunday, which is the Vigil of Christmas, if you receive Holy Communion at the 10 o'clock Mass, you certainly may receive Holy Communion again at midnight, because after all, it's another day. However, if you receive Holy Communion at midnight, a midnight Mass, and you happen to want to come to the 10 o'clock Mass Christmas Day, you may not receive Holy Communion again. So keep that distinction in mind. Ember Days. We have Ember Days this week, the Winter Ember Days. These are days of very particular prayer, and fasting and abstaining. It's obvious that the day before Christmas, or day or two before Christmas, is a fast day too, but it's obvious that on that occasion, you're going to pick a little bit here and pick a little bit there, and you will be picking here, there, and everywhere. Don't worry about that. It's a fast day. But if you find a little something to put into your mouth, don't worry about it. Love God. It's all I ask. A little remark was made in our community the other day, which I think has a lot of bearing. And we can probably carry this over into our own homes. I myself am a little scrupulous about running around and doing all the things that we do in our church in preparation for this occasion. Moving in of this thing and taking out of that thing and whatever, whatever, whatever. And there's a lot of moving and tugging and carrying and whatever. And I have always felt that we ought to take the Blessed Sacrament out of the church. And I was corrected by that, or because of that. And I was told, don't take our Lord out of the church. He loves to sit there and watch us work for him. I guess that's all I've got to say. May Almighty God bless you and keep you and go home and carry with you the warmth that the love of God, the love of Jesus, has for us.